Well, hello. Dramatic introduction. As the weather outside has turned cold, the fireplace is back on, and it's time to talk about a composer from faraway Scandinavia, and that's, of course, the great Jean Sibelius. As I mentioned during our nationalist lecture a few vlogs ago, Sibelius falls under the category of nationalist composers. And sort of unusual in the sense that most of the nationalists represent composers from lands that were under control of the Austro-Hungarian Empire and were looking to celebrate something about their cultural pride that was lost within the larger structure of the government and the region that government occupied. In the case of Sibelius, Finland had long been under control of its neighbor, Russia. And Sibelius, his dates were 1865 to 1957. And one of the more unusual characters in the history of music when we sort of look at their career trajectory and what he accomplished during that time. As a young man, he was very interested in music. Didn't start the violin until maybe a little bit late in life in order to become the virtuoso that he dreamed of becoming. Actually started by studying law. And finally in 1885, so at the age of about 20, he started pursuing music as his vocation. Split interests between violin and composition, and he was actually quite saddened when he gave up his bow for his pen. He spent the year of 1889 to 1890 abroad in Berlin, and the following year, 1890 to 1891, he studied in Vienna. And it was during the time in Berlin, I believe, that he heard an early tone poem by a Finnish composer that may well have inspired him to really become interested in celebrating the plight of his homeland and his native people. From a young age, he had a real interest in nature, and that's something that we're going to hear really throughout the works that we're going to take a listen to today. While he was abroad on the continent, he was able to also hear the premiere of Strauss's Don Juan that we talked about a few classes ago. And he also really fell in love with the music of Bruckner. We find major influences from Beethoven as well as from Wagner. And I think there's also quite a bit that he would have drawn from with Liszt. So his early works, and this is really everything up until about 1900, really reflect nationalist impulses, and that's something we're going to see throughout as well. And the works from that time period represent some of his most famous tone poems, incidental music from plays, all mostly inspired by the sense of Finnish pride and Finnish nationalism and a desire for his homeland to have its independence. Now, from that point, about 1899, he is going to turn his attention to writing symphonies for the first time. So it's at the age of about 34 that he writes his first symphony. And in that, we see a lot of this influence of potentially Bruckner and Wagner, but no composer, I think, was more influential to him at this phase than, well, why don't we listen and you let me know?
Thank you.
If you guessed Tchaikovsky, you're absolutely right. A beautiful, sweeping, romantic melody. The orchestration, very similar to what Tchaikovsky himself would have used, the traditional paired winds. He doesn't use the third flute, so just two flutes. The low brass section is going to feature three trombones and a tuba, and he'll also use a harp to go along with timpani. And that's really the extent of the orchestra that Sibelius would use. In fact, he would use tuba in the second symphony and not again for the remaining five. He wrote a total of seven over the course of his creative output. So that represents what the Stedman book talks about as this finished period of composition. And I have to say, I'm going to take issue with the next three segments that Stedman breaks his career into. And the way I'd like to look at this is really thinking about from 1901, so literally everything that comes after that first symphony, up until about 1920, is a period of development and evolution of style. And I think the work that I want to spend a bit of time looking at is actually the second symphony, and that's obviously the one that came immediately after. Sibelius was influenced by very much an amateur critic, and by 1901, this critic had encouraged Sibelius, you know, I think you ought to take your family and you should go to Italy. That it would provide a lot of inspiration for you. And eventually he did, and spent much of that winter of 1901 into 1902 coming up with the material that would become the Second Symphony. And this, while we hear a very heroic work in D major, the First Symphony was in E minor, it's actually going to be the beginning of plotting of a new course that Sibelius is going to follow. And we're going to start by listening to the exposition of this. And you're going to hear a lot of different fragments of ideas that are going to come by. And something to understand about this middle period of Sibelius, which is going to cover most of the symphonies, 2 through 5, he's going to be on a constant quest to make his music more cohesive, more efficient. He's going to use traditional classical forms, but he's trying to find ways to merge things together so that we don't need the rambling four-movement sprawl that we see in the First Symphony, and even a bit in the Second. So we're going to start with the exposition of the first movement of the Second Symphony, which to me sounds a bit like a shaggy dog, or maybe we have a different analogy we'll talk about in a moment.
Thank you.
Of course, I forgot to mention that this is the required listening. Right. Well, as you just heard, a whole lot of different musical ideas that are going by in a hurry. There's a quote that Sibelius himself said about the symphony, that it is as though the Almighty had thrown the pieces of a mosaic down from the floor of heaven and told me to put them together. Well, as I mentioned, Sibelius becomes very interested in formal efficiency, and nothing is more important to him than motivic development. There's actually some theories that say that Sibelius would start with the full melody and then work his way backwards to come up with the different ideas that would eventually lead to that. Well, over the course of the development, he takes some of these smaller fragments and turns them into a larger structure. And then through the span of the recapitulation, it's in sonata form, he actually sort of dims the lights on the mosaic until it sort of goes out of focus. So the bulk of the movement is actually in the development, and I think you're going to really enjoy listening to that in its entirety. So that's the first movement of the Second Symphony in D major. As you heard, there's still a lot of interest or reflection of inspiration from folk ideas, nature. I hear quite a bit of these sort of soaring grand vistas of Finland. Just beautiful music. Where this work really plots a bit of a new course for Sibelius is in the third movement and the fourth movement. So the third movement is a traditional scherzo, and then it's actually going to lead us straight into the fourth movement. I'm going to play that transition for you so you get an idea of how this is going to work. So I left a slight hesitation as a break so you could hear the change from the third movement into the fourth movement. But just to sort of unpack what you've just listened to, we had there was a melodic idea from the third movement that has been turned into a very simple gesture of just three notes. It's become quite tiny, and then it's sequenced up. Of course, there's lots of sound being layered on top of it. And finally, the arrival of the fourth movement starts with the first theme, which is actually just an elongated version of the motive that was the transition. Okay, so a melody from the third movement was fragmented, used as a transition to bringing us into the fourth movement, where it's transformed into the main melody of that movement, okay? This is Beethoven-like in the way that this was handled. And then not unlike in Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, at the end of the development section, he actually recreates that crescendo, and so the start of the recap is actually reminiscent of the transition from the third movement into the fourth movement. So it's this idea of revisiting the transition from the third into the fourth that is identical to what Beethoven did in the Fifth Symphony, Sibelius does here in the Second Symphony. Before we turn our attention away from the Second Symphony, I think it's also important that we understand this important inspiration that comes from Bruckner. And another idea, while this symphony is in major, D major, Sibelius will spend long stretches of even the major key symphonies by working through ideas in minor. So what we're going to hear is an excerpt from near the end of the Second Symphony, where he's going to start very quiet, not unlike Bruckner, with an ostinato passage in the strings. The winds are going to present fragments of an idea that will evolve into a melody that will be repeated a number of times, not unlike Tchaikovsky, but always at a greater dynamic with larger forces. It's going to work its way around the orchestra. And despite the fact that the symphony is in D major, all of this ostinato work occurs in D minor until finally a triumphant arrival in D major. Here's an excerpt from that last movement of Sibelius' Second Symphony. So it's wonderful music. Just after that, this climactic D major unfolds. And I came to recognize the first time I worked on this that anytime Sibelius moves to offbeats in the horns, it's time to get excited. Something good's going to happen. So that's the Second Symphony. And again, the major thing to understand is that he's moved away from this Tchaikovsky-inspired late romantic emotional outpouring, and he's trying to find a new language in which motivic development is used and where motives are very cohesive. He's able to build larger structures off a real economy of notes, an economy of gesture, very similar to Beethoven, but it doesn't sound at all like Beethoven. It's a very unique a unique voice, and that's one of the things that I think is a hallmark of Sibelius, and really any great composer, is when they've identified their own unique sound. Now, following this, again, the Stedman book goes into a whole series of ideas of what different phases might be. I really think that from symphonies 2 through five, he's trying to find ways to blur the lines of the four traditional movements of the symphony, and also to make things more concise. So the third symphony is very neoclassical. It's in C major, lots of folk inspiration, lots of ostinato. Very interesting, as you already heard in the second symphony, he will go back and forth between groupings of two and three, sort of like Bruckner, pretty regularly. Does the same thing in the third symphony. And in the third symphony, he actually only has three movements. The third movement is kind of a combination of a scherzo and a finale, but he's constantly trying to make things more concise. The fourth movement is, without a doubt, the darkest, the fourth symphony, without a doubt, the darkest one that he wrote. This was actually written in 1911. I should have mentioned the third symphony was from 1907. And in the time in between, in 1907, he had spent some time with Mahler, and they had an exchange where Sibelius said something along the lines of, "The essence of a symphony is a severity of style and the profound logic that is created through an interconnection among all the motives." Okay, that's a mouthful, but this idea of everything should be able to be recognizable as coming from the same place, that the motives will hold the work together as different as they might sound. Mahler said, "I disagree. The symphony should be like the world. It must embrace everything," which is why over the course of his career, it seems that Mahler's symphonies were becoming more expansive, whereas Sibelius's are actually getting more concise. They also had a realization that as their works were evolving, that for every symphony they wrote, they developed a new group of fans. Their audience came to expect certain things. And then they were always disappointed by what came next. The first symphony, so romantic, so lush. The second symphony, very heroic. And then the third one, neoclassical, much shorter. Was very confusing to audiences. The fourth one, very dark, very introspective in A minor, and that brings us to the fifth symphony, which was written in 1915. Now, he struggled a great deal with this, and I want you to hear why in just a moment. While the fourth symphony uses four separate movements, he actually uses repetitive motives that can be found throughout. Okay, this idea of motives to create cohesion, that everything is related, very important to Sibelius and the direction that he's going to. So in the fifth symphony, he returns to a major key. He's in E flat, and tremendous inspiration of nature. The last symphony, he was inspired by being out in the great outdoors and seeing swans fly. So I'm going to play a bit of the end of the fifth symphony for you, and I'm really curious to know what you think of the ending of this. Just happened. That was my reaction the first time I heard it. I can't think of a work that is more dependent on performance and almost the body language of the orchestra and the conductor to make it work, to make it be effective. So Sibelius has eliminated the scherzo. He's created a finale, and it's based entirely on this idea of swans in flight. It's a very unusual melody, this yom, beam, bom, beam, bom. The top note is played by one player. The bottom two notes are played by other players within the brass. That was the way he makes that work. And then up to these chords that have either been referred to as comical or carrying all of the weight of the world. Now, he worked on multiple versions of this symphony and wasn't really satisfied with it until the 1919 version, which is what you've just heard. In fact, he continued to revise many of the earlier works into the 1920s. I should also mention that during the teens, we had a variety of things that occurred. World War I, we also have the Russian Revolution, and that was immediately followed by a Finnish Civil War that pitted the Reds against the Whites, and Sibelius and his wife were in a very problematic time where they actually worried about their safety. And I should mention that Sibelius, over the course of his lifetime, suffered a great deal battling with alcoholism, and indebtedness. His social, his personal life went through all these ebbs and flows that seemed to sort of follow behind the alcoholism. So finally, when we arrive in 1920, Sibelius has found a mature language. He's found ways to be unbelievably concise. And this in 1923, the Sixth Symphony is born, and it's essentially four idyllic movements that are thematically very related to the last symphony, Symphony No. 7, which is written in 1924. And this is a work that I don't know that it gets enough credit in the world. Now, a number of critics have referred to this as his single greatest accomplishment, but it's not a work that's performed regularly. The second symphony is performed all the time. The first symphony is performed with a lot of regularity. The fifth symphony with some regularity. Three and four, not so much. Six, not as much at all. But then in the seventh, Sibelius creates a cohesive, concise symphony with all the range of emotions that you would expect to find in a large symphony, but he does it in one movement. And he seems to have found a way to master time and the control of time so that there are subtle changes in pulse that go on that are almost not noticed by the audience. So by the time you reach the end, you realize you've been on an amazing voyage, amazing trip, but you're not necessarily aware of where each of these individual moments happened. It sounds quite cerebral, and I guess in many ways the music is cerebral. I wrestled a great deal with how much of this work to share with you, and I put the entire Seventh Symphony in the supplemental playlist within Spotify. But I thought it would be a great opportunity to listen to the closing stretch. The opening of the work has got a timpani roll and a string choir divided, the string sections divided into seven, eight, even nine parts, and it just grows until this beautiful C major moment where trombone and then horn just seem to layer over each other. There's a moment where we seem to be out at a dark and stormy sea, and there's moments in nature, and then suddenly we return to this idea. So we're going to take that last transition. Sounds a little bit reminiscent of the way that the second symphony, that motion from the scherzo into the last movement, occurs. And then we're just going to experience this layering of sound between trumpets and horns. The music will die away. There's an impassioned moment from the violins, and then it just melts into one of the most complex brief moments you could ever hear in music, a series of suspensions in the horns. There's a moment of optimism, and then he just sustains C major sitting on the leading tone, T, B natural, before it finally resolves up to C major. What comes after that? Well, this is 1924. He'll complete a few more works into 1926. He'll live until 1957. And not complete another significant work. We refer to this as the silence of Yarvenpa, the silence of Yarvenpa. I'll put the spelling underneath in one of the slides as you listen to it. So I hope you enjoy this conclusion to Sibelius' Seventh Symphony, where his life's work will end with a resolution from B to C in C major.